Since March 19, 1979, C-SPAN, a public service funded by the cable television industry, began giving you direct access to government in an innovative way by putting you, the viewer, into the rooms where politics is debated and policies are determined. C-SPAN began as a bold initiative. Now, 45 years later, we are essential for those wanting to see democracy at work without editing or commentary. With continued cable support, we've done this without a dime of government funding, maintaining our independence. As we mark 45 years, the business of media is rapidly changing, and now your support is crucial for our mission's future. Support our legacy of unfiltered access by donating today at cspan.org/donate.
Reporter Danny Casolaro was found dead over the weekend in a motel in Martinsburg, West Virginia.
Local authorities quickly ruled his death a suicide.
It just didn't sit right. In my mind, I'm thinking they killed him.
The book that Danny was writing, he starts looking into these powerful people and realizes there's something much bigger going on.
These eight men, they're no longer government officials, but their tentacles can reach into any part of government in almost any country. I've come to call this group the Octopus.
Most of us were convinced that he had been hurt for him covering this story.
If the federal government says, we don't know what you're talking about, it's beyond what a couple of local detectives can do.
It all started with the software promise.
These programs allegedly allowed the CIA to spy on the intelligence agencies that bought it.
The two of them transferred in excess of $40 million.
This money was used to buy off.
It was a disturbing conspiracy.
A lot of people that reported on there are dead.
The Octopus Murders on Netflix, Christian Hansen. This is a pretty complicated story. How do you tell it in a nutshell?
So if I'm in an elevator that's moving very quickly, I'd say that it's a murder mystery, spy thriller documentary that centers on the life and research of a reporter from DC named Danny Casolaro.
How'd you find it?
I was studying the private prison industry, and I started looking into the history of a company called Wackenhut, which had the first private prison in America, but it also had a huge multinational security concern. And I basically, just digging into the company, learned about an obscure operation that involved attempts to manufacture, or plans to manufacture, biological and chemical weapons and night vision goggles and submachine guns on a Native American reservation in the Coachella Valley. And that Danny Casolaro got folded into that research because he was looking into that operation as well as part of a larger book project that he was working on in the last year of his life, when at the end of which he died mysteriously.
How long have you been working on the Octopus Murders?
I started studying it in 2012.
And it went through when? When did you finish?
Oh, and the movie came out in just a month ago on Netflix. It's a documentary series, and I'm still researching it. So I haven't quit.
So you're about 12 years into this at this point. Would you consider it an obsession?
I mean, yes, but I also think other people have a negative connotation to the word obsession. Deep interest? No, I don't know. I'll take obsession.
Zachary Treitz, how did you get involved in this?
I'm Christian's friend, basically. And my background is more in independent film, feature, you know, fictional film. And Christian started telling me about this, you know, probably back in 2012, 2013. And I was just his buddy. He would tell me some of the people that he was looking into and organizations, and told me about Danny. And I was just a sounding board for years. And then in 2017, Christian and I took a trip to visit, to pick up one of Danny Casolaro's main sources from prison, who had been there for 26 years. So that's when we filmed that trip, and that wasn't intended to be anything. We had no designs to make a documentary at that point, but we just knew that it was a big moment for Christian and the story. So we, as a filmmaker, I filmed it. So off and on, I guess, since 2017, and it picked up steam a few years ago when we really decided to make it into this Netflix series.
And the trailer that we saw at the beginning of this program said that you also produced a series called Wild Wild Country. What was that?
Well, that's our producers, the Duplass brothers and the Stardust Frames, the guys McLean and Chapman Way. They directed Wild Wild Country. So that whole group that made Wild Wild Country, they took us on as kind of like their next project.
They
helped us get off the ground. Yeah, they were our shepherds.
Christian Hansen, Zachary Treitz, what is Danny Casolaro's background? Who was he?
Danny Casolaro was from, he was born in McLean, Virginia, and his father was an obstetrician, delivered a lot of DC and Virginia babies. And Danny was a writer. He actually, you know, he kind of went back and forth between journalism and poetry and fiction. In the early 70s, he investigated the Watergate case. I found evidence of that in the FBI files. They were tracking his Watergate investigation. And then throughout the late 70s and 80s, Danny wrote about the computer industry for a small DC-based newsletter called Computer Age, which, you know, if you think back to the late 70s and early 80s, writing about computers was pretty obscure. The computer industry was small and it was highly technical, and, you know, there were no personal computers really to speak of. These were like huge, huge computers. Anyways, Danny published this newsletter, you know. It was not necessarily something he was insanely passionate about. He had a child when he was about 21. So yeah, I think it was a stable source of income for him. And he wrote about computers, and he really dug into it. And then he sold the publication in about 1990 and started pitching ideas, more interesting, more complex stories. And basically a colleague, former colleague from his computer publication came along and said, "Hey, I got this crazy lawsuit. This DC software company is suing the DOJ. I think you should look into it." And that's when Danny's odyssey into this story that eventually became known as The Octopus began.
Well, let's show some more video from the Netflix series, The Octopus Murders.
In order to figure out what happened to Danny, I wanted to see what he was seeing. And then I realized I should just finish the book that Danny was writing.
A lot of people that reported on it are dead. I'm not just gonna turn and walk away now, you know, just because, you know, I'm scared, you know?
It all sounded a little weird to me. I mean, was Christian, my friend Christian, this guy, really about to expose the most dangerous political conspiracy of the century? Or had he fallen into some kind of paranoid fantasy? So I went along with him as he tried to finish what Danny Casolaro started.
and uncover the secrets of the octopus.
It's a dangerous game and I want no part of it.
Stop contacting and trying to contact him.
Understood.
You want to be the next Danny Casolaro?
This is not your thing. You don't know this world.
Hey, Christian.
Yo.
All right, so what's the deal?
He said that I could come out to his property. The only thing that you're not going to like is that I can't bring my phone and I have to be blindfolded on the way out there.
Zachary Treitz, you sounded a little skeptical when this started.
Yeah, I mean, maybe that's my role in Christian's life, especially the beginning of this story was as a little bit of a wet blanket. Just because a lot of the stuff that Danny was looking into and that Christian at the time was looking into was so hard to pin down, seemed very mysterious, and seemed a little, I don't know whether these people were great sources or not. A lot of the people seemed in this world pretty dangerous. So I was worried for Christian, and then I was worried about his own grasp of reality at certain points, because as you see in the series, if you watch it, it gets pretty psychedelic and pretty mind altering in terms of the things that Danny was looking at, the people, the organizations, and the intelligence community related things and criminal community related things that they were looking into.
At what point, Zachary Treitz, did you search for financing for this?
We're still searching. No. When we pitched it to our producers, I think in like 2018 or 2019, and they were the first people that were just seemed to grasp exactly what we were doing. And so they helped us develop a pitch deck, and then we pitched it to Netflix. It was the only pitch we did. So yeah, somewhere in 2019 or so. Yeah.
And as far as Netflix viewership, how has it been doing?
It seems to have done pretty well. Yeah. Millions of people have watched it. It was on the top 10 for a couple weeks at least. It was the number two show on their platform in the United States. I think it was like number four worldwide, which is, I think, for a humble operation like the one we're running, pretty good.
Well, Christian Hansen, in that last video we saw, there was a basement setting with just lots of boxes. Where was that?
A good friend from Kentucky owns a duplex, and he said, as long as I was writing and researching on the book back in the early stages, I could work in his lower empty apartment. He lived in the upper two floors, and he had an empty furnished floor. And so I, you know, moved in there and just wrote full time. Then another friend of mine, who's a songwriter, decided, if Christian can have a residency here, I guess I can too, and I'll write songs. And then that guy got annoyed that I'd taken over the dining room with all my papers everywhere. And he's like, just put it away at night. And I didn't, that wasn't part of my process at that point. So I was annoyed, and in a huff, I set up an office down at the workbench in the dank basement. And that day, a photographer friend from DC named Peter Von Ochtmel, he was in town. We both went to the Kentucky Derby. That's why I'm wearing a suit. And I was like, yeah, I just got this letter from Michael Reconosciuto. You should, you know, come photograph my weird workspace and look at this letter. So that's the story behind that photo. No one's ever asked about that before.
What were you doing in 2012 when you began this project?
I was I had lived in New York for about 3 years, and I was photographing for the New York Times. Then my younger sister got cancer, and I went back to Kentucky to be near her. She's fine now. I had dropped out of college. So while I was back, I went ahead and took my last few classes to get a degree. And it was in one of those classes that I was researching the private prison industry. And that's pretty much, you know, referring back to my earlier answer about the Wackenhead Corporation. That was how that came about.
Zachary Treitz, you wanted to say something?
Oh, no, I was just going to, I think we might have been talking about two different basements in that thing.
Sorry, I couldn't.
I think he was talking about the boxes that we found on the West Coast, but whatever.
No, we haven't gotten there yet. We're still at the beginning stages of this. So.
Right, the train has bolted. It's fine.
Well, the nub of this story is August 10th, 1991. Let's look at some more video.
Front desk called me on walkie-talkie. They said, we need you in 517. I said, well, what do I need to bring? A toilet plunger or what? They said, your courage. And that's when I walked in and saw what I saw. It was just messy. I can't, for lack of a better explanation, it was messy.
What was the mess?
The bloody handprints all over the wall and smeared on the wallpaper and all over the countertop and just blood everywhere. The housekeepers told me they still didn't know if there was someone in that tub or not. And I was just ever so slowly peeking around the edge just to see if there was a body in here. And I could see the tub was full of blood. And I was like, man, I don't want to look around that corner. You know, it was just something spooky about it. So I decided to peek through here, the hinge crack. And at that point, I said that there's someone in there. I'm betting they're not alive. Something very wrong had taken place in here.
Zachary Treitz, what were we just watching?
That was the one of the maintenance workers at the Sheraton Hotel describing what he found on August 10th, 1991 at the Sheraton in Martinsburg. I mean, he had been called up because a maid had found some blood on the floor. And we met him. We knew his name from, I think, some police reports or something. And so we sought him out and just convinced him on that day that it would be okay. And, you know, asked him if it would be okay for him to just explain the basics of what he had seen that day. And I think he was pretty reluctant to do that at first. It was obviously a pretty traumatic day in his life, but also Martinsburg is a small town. I don't think that he wanted to ruffle any feathers. But luckily he just kind of agreed at the last minute and took us through the room.
Did you?
Yeah, he was reluctant, but Zach was like, "We don't want your opinions. We just want to know what you saw, what actually happened," and that assuaged him because, you know, he can't argue with facts, you know.
And just to be clear, Danny Casolaro was found in the bathtub, full of blood. Correct?
Yes, Peter.
And did you have to rent the room to get all that footage? How did you get the hotel to agree to this?
I believe we rented the room and the adjoining room to keep all of our boxes and gear in.
Was Danny Casolaro's death a suicide or a murder? What was the official report at that time?
The official report from the Martinsburg police was that Danny committed suicide, and then the FBI and DOJ did a review of the Martinsburg Police Department's findings and on officially upheld those the suicide finding.
Did you have trouble getting people in Martinsburg to talk besides the maintenance worker?
I had a lot of trouble getting the police chief, who was the chief investigator of the Casler case, to talk.
Why do you think that was?
he said it wouldn't be proper to discuss a closed case, which I don't agree with that. I talk to police about old closed cases all the time, and they usually like talking about their history, and they're allowed to.
Was there FBI involvement in this case at this point?
At this point, yes and no. I mean, Danny was talking to a FBI agent in Los Angeles about some organized crime dealings he was looking into. He was talking to another FBI agent in the DC area who was kind of a white collar crime specialist. And then he supposedly was going to meet with two FBI agents from Lexington, Kentucky, that sort of on that trip in which he died. We got the name of one of those agents, but he had passed and his wife, you know, wasn't able or willing to help us. So we're not sure about that. So there was some FBI involvement, you know, ish, as far as, you know, people Danny was talking to, if that was your question.
And again, why did Danny Casolaro call this the Octopus? Where did that name come from?
So Danny was at the phase in which his research phase, he was pitching his book idea. So that's where you boil down your concept to about a, you know, 6-page kind of enticing synopsis of the story that you're writing, and who are the characters, and what's some of the rising action, and why would a, you know, a publisher want to give you an advance to actually finish the book. And so, you know, there's a certain level of hype in that style of writing, you know. You want to make it seem really enticing, but the Octopus, it was called the Octopus because he starts looking into one DC area, you know, or one 1980s scandal, the Inslaw case. And then that takes him over into the Iran-Contra scandal and the October Surprise and BCCI and Nugan Hand and the savings and loan and the same kind of players, nefarious, you know, players are their names are popping up here and there and there. So he, you know, he seems like it's part of interconnected, you know, more of like a web, but he, you know, the Octopus is such a good literary image. I guess he went with that.
So we're talking here about Ronald Reagan and George H.W. Bush and the Mafia and the CIA and the FBI, Iran-Contra, BCCI, all these famous issues that we've had throughout our history. Zachary Treitz, at what point did you ever think, okay, we're in over our heads here? What are we doing?
I think pretty much from day one, we were in over our heads and kind of acknowledged that. I mean, when Christian was first, when we were first talking about doing some kind of project together, Christian had asked me, you know, like, what about the Octopus? What if we did that as a, you know, did a documentary? And I was just like, it's too hard. You know, it can't be done. I don't know, Christian, you might remember that better than me.
Yeah, we were Zach was looking for his next project. I was stuck. You know, I had been working on this thing by myself, self-funded for 7 years or something at this point. And we were at half court on, you know, at the net on a tennis court where we played tennis together. And we were kind of figuring out what we're going to do next and Zach was going to do next. And, you know, a few ideas that he had and that I had separate to this had fallen through. And Zach seemed kind of discouraged. And I said, you know, Zach, well, what about the Octopus? We could do the Octopus. And he's, you know, he sighed and really emphatically said it was too hard. And then a week later I saw him and he'd already started, writing this, you know, pitch deck and doing the initial steps of, you know, pre-production. So I guess at some point he decided, it could be done and he saw a path forward and, you know, here we are today.
What's difficult about this story is that we were essentially researching while we're trying to tell the story, which is always hard. It's good to traditionally do your research, find out what's going on, and then complete your book, film, whatever you're doing. So we were researching, Christian was researching, and then I jumped into that as well, up until essentially the end of our project. We never stopped because there's almost a limitless number of things to find out in this story. And so that makes it really difficult. The complexity of the story makes it really difficult. The number of names and the access makes it really hard, because it's a story not only about people and events that happened 30, 40 years ago, sometimes even more. And a lot of those people have since passed away, including our main character, Danny. And so there were just a lot of obstacles towards being able to both find out what happened and being able to tell that story of what happened.
And Christian Hansen, you were acting as Danny Casolaro throughout the series too, whenever we would see reenactments, correct?
Yes, that is true. I think that might be the first time that's been done in a documentary, but I could be wrong.
Now,
I just want to say, you know, it wasn't just a vanity project, that choice. You know, that choice came from Christian talking to Danny's family and his friends. And when I was there, it just kept coming up over and over again. Like they would look at Christian like they'd seen a ghost, because he looked so similar to Danny. They would just say, like, oh, man, it's just strange being here with you because you look so much like Danny. And, you know, Christian's trying to follow literally in Danny's footsteps in his investigation. And so that became too, you know, when that happens, I guess, as a filmmaker, you don't just let that opportunity go. You know, we had to step into it. But, you know, Christian even took acting classes and we tried to do it right and push him forward. So that it wouldn't feel strange or, you know, too hokey for that part.
Well, Danny's brother, Dr. Tony Casolaro, participated. Here's some of Dr. Casolaro.
Danny and I stood in our kitchen and talked for a long time about what was going on. He didn't tell me a lot of the details except that it was a vast, disturbing conspiracy. And in this whole world that he had been looking into, some of the same people kept appearing. I don't know why Martinsburg, but apparently Danny was supposed to meet with a source in West Virginia. But I can't tell you whom he was meeting with. I just don't know the answer. Danny told me that he was getting some funny phone calls and some threats. And it was then that he said to me, you know, by the way, if an accident happens, it's not an accident.
Was the family eager to participate in this, to have this exposed?
The Casolaro family has been approached by researchers ever since, I mean, since it happened, you know, and they the last interview that they gave, that Anne Clank, and who's Danny's best friend, and Tony, Danny's brother, gave, was in 1993 for Unsolved Mysteries. And then that was it until we came along and we were able to gain their trust. And I think at that point they did want to have some finality. You know, things were kind of left up in the air with Unsolved Mysteries, and we did our best to bring more closure to this very deeply sad and really kind of psychically confusing case.
And this is a, did you two change in the 12 years that you've been working on this? Do you feel that you changed at all because of this story?
I do. Yeah, I think I do. But, you know, I also, I try to stay positive and joyful. But yeah, I'm definitely curious. But I also know that how long it takes to do a investigation of something really complex, which is now something that I find that I love to do. I kind of feel like I don't know anything until I've like really dug into it.
Now, you mentioned former MSNBC producer Ann Klink, who also participated in this series. Who else should we know about who helped you along this path?
I mean, Zach, what do you, what can,
well, I mean, so
there's
an almost infinite number of people, because the story, just to give us a quick overview of the story, it's like we start in DC and we'll start in Martinsburg and talk about Danny's final days in Martinsburg. We go back to Washington, DC, and we talk about the computer software scandal that he was working on. And then we head out to the West Coast, to Southern California, to this Native American reservation where, as Christian mentioned earlier, a company called Wackenhut was developing weapons and military equipment on this reservation. There's a triple homicide there. Then we went up to San Francisco, and there's a very mysterious and scary homicide that happened to one of our Michael Reconosciuto's business partners, one of Danny Source's business partners, all connected to this kind of West Coast group of very brilliant, very scary, in my mind, people. And then you expand outward sort of internationally with the things that Danny was looking into in terms of arms deals, drug deals, covert action and stuff like that, political scandals around the world. So it's like, who helped us? You know, it's like every single person you see interviewed, obviously. And then
we talked to we talked to hundreds of people that didn't, you know, sit on camera, you know, just for background information and clarity, and or like they know someone who knows someone. Maybe one of those people appeared, you know, in the film.
Well, one of those people that you talk to often and who does appear in video is Bill Hamilton. Here's a little bit of his story from the series.
He started sending me thousands of emails.
He's giving me leads. He's giving me documents to corroborate these things. Before I could even wrap my mind around the first thing he sent me, he'd send me something else and something else and something else. It was an unbelievable time in my life. I was like fully dedicated to this story, and I had this source who was too.
Pretty early on in my talks with Bill, he points out that there's an archive at a university in Missouri where all or many of Danny's notes are stashed. So I went there and copied all of it. It took 5 days. Okay, so these are some of Danny's handwritten notes. It's a mess of scribbles, but I've learned to really be able to read his handwriting. Phone numbers, arrows, names, corporations. The archive was thousands of pages of research materials. I realized that it was basically a blueprint of the book that he was writing. And it was about a series of interrelated international crimes, starting with the Inslaw case.
Gentlemen, what was the Inslaw case, and who is Bill Hamilton?
How many hours do we have to do this, you know? Christian, you want to take it?
Sure. Bill Hamilton is a former NSA NSA employee who founded a company called, or an organization called, the Institute for Law and Social Research, which later became Inslaw. And their main product was a was a software system for prosecutors to, in the early days of computing, to take the paper files of a prosecutor's office and digitize them into a sort of a database where the information could be referenced and cross-referenced and broken down and analyzed, and you could find trends and patterns, you know, stuff that would have been just absolutely impossible with, you know, filing cabinets. And then, you know, eventually the database is at, you know, a U.S. attorney's office in Miami, for instance, could be connected to the U.S. attorney's office in Nashville, you know what I'm saying? And there could be, you know, connectivity and this. So basically the reason why we're talking about this company today is because there was this contract dispute between the Department of Justice, who was contracting with Inslough for their Promise software. And it led to an 8 years long legal battle and led to Bill coming up with sources who were telling him that the software was stolen as part of a and by the way, two courts ruled that the Justice Department stole the software using trickery, fraud, and deceit. And then but he didn't know why. It was unclear why. And what he began to believe was that it was part of an international espionage operation where the software was distributed to other in law enforcement and intelligence agencies around the world with a secret back door in it, kind of sold through third parties. It seemed like, you know, normal software distributors. And that's sort of the Inslough case.
So how did Bill Hamilton, who founded the Promise software, get in touch with Danny Casolaro?
They had a mutual friend, a guy named Terry Miller, who we interviewed. Terry was a computer contracts expert and consultant. He would, you know, consult on, you know, IBM contracts and huge computer contracts. And he also wrote about, you know, what's happening in the world of government software procurement. He knew Danny was a tenacious reporter, and Bill Hamilton was at that stage where he'd won two court rulings saying the Department of Justice stole the software. He was at a point where he needed to figure out why, and collaborating with a reporter, you know, an investigative reporter who has their own interest in mind is like, you know, free legal investigative work. I think that was what Bill wanted, was Danny to hopefully find some answers.
So this is the early mid 80s, and this is pretty cutting edge software at this point, correct?
Yes.
Why were Danny Casolaro's papers at the University of Missouri? How did they end up there?
There's an organization for investigative reporters called Investigative Reporters and Editors. And it was founded after a reporter in Arizona named Don Bowles was murdered in a car bombing that was connected to reporting he was doing on organized crime in Phoenix, I think. A consortium of journalists descended on Arizona to basically finish his reporting and then this organization was founded to support investigative reporters, and it's housed within the University of Missouri in Columbia, which is the oldest journalism school in the U.S. So initially, Danny's papers were sent to the IRE, it's kind of a small ragtag organization. I think their funding comes from just members, like. It's like $80 a year to become a member. And the university or the Missouri State Historical Society has a really nice archive facility. And so they took over Danny's files for the IRE. So they're just kind of randomly in Missouri. It's a little inconvenient, but that's where they are.
Zachary Treitz, do you consider Bill Hamilton a reliable source?
Put me on the spot here. I think that Bill, in my mind, was a very well-meaning person, as far as I could tell, who wanted answers to a very complicated, difficult to discern story of what had happened to his software and what had happened to his company, which went bankrupt trying to, you know, fight the Justice Department, essentially. So, you know, when he was talking to Christian over the years, you know, I don't know how you could keep up the volume of communication that Bill did, you know, thousands of emails and tons of calls to Christian without being sincerely trying to find out what happened. As far as his ultimate reliability, that sort of comes into question in the movie, and we grapple with that, and I don't have too much more to say about it than what we put in there, except for maybe I try to get everybody the benefit of the doubt, and it's an extremely complicated story, and it's, I think as we show, it's easy to get lost within the maze of this and to not know what's real and what's not. So that's a very complicated answer to a very complicated question for me.
Gentlemen, there's another person who appears in the Octopus Murders prominently, Michael Reconosciuto. Who is he?
Michael Reconosciuto is a child prodigy from the Pacific Northwest. He ended up going to a elite school in the Portola Valley, and he studied at 16 under the Arthur Shala, who is later won the Nobel Prize for laser research, which Michael was deeply involved in when he was 16. He studied under him, and then Michael ends up in and this is in the mid early and mid 60s. Michael ends up in the Haight-Ashbury scene in San Francisco, and there's a lot of questions with Michael, but then he ends up arrested in 1972 in Seattle for manufacturing LSD and PCP in an underwater lab, or actually a lab that you have to go underwater to access. He went to prison, and he just had this like very colorful life. He's a very complicated character, very hard to sum up, but he ultimately was out on that reservation that we keep bringing back up in the Coachella Valley. He was working on some weapons research projects there for the, you know, that Wackenhut Cabazon joint venture, and later told Bill Hamilton that he had on that reservation installed this back door that we've been alluding to in this interview into the Promise software, and ultimately became a source for Danny. And, you know, he told Danny about his involvement in Promise and about his life, you know, his very colorful, very bizarre life, which then several months into him being a source for Danny, Michael was arrested on federal drug charges, and it ultimately served 26 years in prison.
And to the audience who has not seen the four-part Octopus Murders on Netflix, I apologize. This is not an easy story to tell. You have to watch the four parts to get it. But we're going to show some more video that the producers have provided to us. This is about the Coachella murders. This is John Powers.
In November of 2007, I was told by my sergeant that I would be getting a cold case to look into, and it was a 1981 triple murder, sometimes referred to as one of the tentacles of the Octopus Murders. I investigated it, I solved it, I arrested the person who was responsible, and 9 months later, they let him go. And still to this day, it's a mystery why they let him go.
Christian Hansen, what are we talking about here, and how did we end up in the desert of Southern California?
Yeah, we're talking about, so Michael told Bill Hamilton and Danny that the software was modified on this reservation, and that's where a backdoor was installed into it, which, you know, it was later disseminated, he said, to Canada. So that's how, like, by following the software, that's how you get to Cabazon. But once you get to Cabazon, you realize that this was the first Native American casino in the United States, which later, you know, we don't even have a chance to get into because of the timeline and so much information. It's one of our great regrets. But the Indian Gaming Act came from the Supreme Court case between the Cabazon Band of Mission Indians, who, and, you know, they're ultimately their casino, and the state of California. So that's sort of why we're in Cabazon. And then you have the founder of this, or this kind of enigmatic character named John Philip Nichols that you meet in episode two. He was basically sort of a CIA contractor, as far as we can tell, who had a penchant for hiring murders. And one of the tribal members and two of his friends were killed in a still unsolved triple homicide. This tribal member was questioning a lot of the things that John Philip Nichols was up to, a lot of his tactics, and was accusing him of skimming money from the casino. So John Powers, years later, in about 2010, you know, this case, he was a cold case detective in Riverside County, and this case popped up and he got really deep into it and ended up arresting someone who he believed was responsible for the triple homicide. But that guy ended up getting let go, and he's back in Central America where he had moved after Cabazon.
Now, there's a connection to Iran-Contra and weapons training, and this is on the Cabazon Reservation, a 26-member Indian tribe. Here's some more video from the Octopus Murders.
This is just a bizarre cast of characters who gets together. You had people from the military and the CIA. You've got Michael Reconosciuto and Earl Bryan, a businessman, owner of Hadron, close confidant to President Reagan.
Earl Bryan has denied that he had anything to do with bringing the Promise software out to that reservation. And yet, Indio police records show Michael Reconosciuto and Earl Bryan together, a demonstration of weapons.
And there was also two Contra generals from Nicaragua out there. They had automatic weapons, machine guns, semi-automatic weapons, and night vision goggles.
1J41, 1J42.
Doc Nichols wanted to manufacture weapons for these Contra generals. But why? Why there? It's a very small tribe of 26 people. Well, this was a time when the U.S. government was providing weapons in secret for countries in Central America.
So Zachary Treitz, we've introduced a new character, Earl Bryan. Who was he?
Ooh, Earl Bryan was a guy who was a it's like all of our characters. It's like, how much time do you have, right? Earl Bryan was a neuroscientist or a neurosurgeon trained as a doctor, who had gone over about two years after he finished his medical school. I think he went over to Vietnam for a couple of years, came back highly decorated, and was a member of then Governor Reagan's California administration in their health department there, and became in charge of that. Later on, he was a guy who he ran for office and wasn't successful and went into business. He eventually actually owned a TV company called Financial News Network, which later became CNBC, which Anne Klink worked at, coincidentally. And he owned UPI, the United Press International, which was at the time the big competitor to the AP, Associated Press, and other companies. He also owned a company that was competing with Inslaw, a company called Hadron, which Bill Hamilton, the owner of Inslaw, alleged that the president of that company, kind of under Earl Bryan, had given him a veiled threat that they were going to find a way to steal the software, find a way to procure the software from Bill Hamilton. And then later on, I guess he was a friend of Reagan's, obviously a sort of what they called the kitchen cabinet of Ronald Reagan when he was president. He also shows up on a police report saying that he was out in the Coachella Valley at this weapons demonstration. And then later on, he went to prison for fraud, as a lot of people in a lot of characters in our story went to prison. He was indicted for financial manipulations related to his company's basically kind of pilfering or inflating the value of those companies. Very complicated character. He kind of was a bad guy in Bill Hamilton's mind. And Danny Casolaro had wanted to interview him, try to talk to him. In fact, did talk to him at a company picnic that Anne Klink invited Danny to. I wish that was a story we wish we could have gotten into the documentary, where Danny's friend worked at Financial News Network, and Earl Bryan and Danny actually played a game of volleyball together when Danny was trying to use that as a way into interviewing him. But Earl Bryan, as large and seemingly unfit as he was, a big guy, just totally schooled Danny at volleyball. Was a great volleyball player, and as I understand it, a great tennis player.
So is this a follow the money story, Christian Hansen?
Yeah, follow the money, follow the software, and follow the unsolved murders, I'd say.
Is it a conspiracy?
Yeah, I think so. That's a word for it. Very loaded and charged word, for sure.
It is, but go ahead and explain why you say that.
Well, I mean, for instance, there's a murder in episode 3 in San Francisco, for instance, and that was very classic, which is today unsolved, but I make a really good case of what happened and why in the film. And you have John Philip Nichols, Philip Arthur Thompson, and Marshall Reconosciuto, Michael Reconosciuto's dad, basically planning the murder in a restaurant a block from his house. You know, two or more people planning a crime is a conspiracy. And we also know about how much money the killer was getting paid. He was on retainer from Michael Reconosciuto's father. And I don't know, it's very confusing. But also, if the software was really stolen, and half of this stuff that people are saying is true regarding what happened with it, it was covered up. And if it was stolen and covered up, that would be a conspiracy. But then again, with Danny Casolaro's, there's a lot of stuff with his death that looks like a cover up, but can actually be very easily explained away as shoddy police work.
In the opening video, Zachary Treitz, you ask on camera whether or not Christian is about to expose the biggest conspiracy of all time, or if this is a paranoia. What have you concluded after 12 years working on this?
Well, so there's conspiracy and there's conspiracy theory, I guess, is the kind of, you know, an important line to draw, right? And I think that Danny's story at the time that Christian was researching it lived, if it lived at all, in the popular imagination, which it really just kind of lived in certain circles on the internet and some people who remembered an Unsolved Mysteries episode from the 90s, as a conspiracy theory, a kind of both Danny's death and the thing that he was working on is seen as kind of like this one conspiracy theory to rule them all kind of thing, right? That all of these people are connected in the intelligence world, and all these scandals, these political scandals that we've already mentioned, Iran-Contra, BCCI, savings and loan, Insula, all these things are one big conspiracy or conspiracy theory. So I think that what I've discovered is that the word conspiracy theory, which is kind of a bad word in many people's minds these days, especially after recent history, which we do not touch on in any way whatsoever. We do not try to graft the past onto the present. Because of that word being kind of like a way that you can dismiss people as lunatics or unhinged or just, wayward in their thought process, it's a good way to kind of dismiss what Danny Casolaro was working on. What I discovered, and what I think we discovered through this process, was seeing that Danny was, no matter what happened to Danny, that Danny was onto an unbelievably rich story filled with con artists and liars and criminals, but also those people did have real connections to the intelligence community, and that Danny was onto an amazing story. I mean, what I think is an amazing story, what I think that has been proven by us telling his story is an amazing story, just because people are watching it and seem to mostly enjoy it. I get a little bit frustrated when it gets lumped in with, this is just a conspiracy theory. It's like a lot of this stuff, as we explain in the show itself, was once considered a conspiracy theory and then turns out to be true. I mean, it's not so simple as just saying, these things, like, just because we'll never know what happened, or just because of who's telling us, like, it's just a conspiracy theory, don't worry about it.
Christian Hansen, are you still investigating?
Yes. I mean, you see when we pull out and show this larger map of connections, we have it structured with tentacles, and basically to me all of those tentacles are great films, great stories, and then people also, since the show's come out, that kind of had fascinating firsthand experiences with different aspects of both the story we present and the parts of the larger story, and new stories have come forward and messaged me, on Twitter and Instagram, and if they found my email. So I simple answer, yes. But I'm also taking a little break, but yeah, I can't wait to get back into it full time again.
And there is an online community now regarding the Octopus Murders, talking about Danny Casolaro and some of the people that you feature in this, aren't there? Do you ever check those out?
I don't. I mean, I think Reddit is probably the place that's really happening. But I don't know. I've just been lost in my own research, and I've tapped into those communities, but they're mostly discussing materials that I put on the internet in 2015. I put a lot of material, me and another researcher named Emma Best put a trove of work. I gave it to Emma and she put it on archive.org, and there's just thousands of pages concerning the Casolaro case and the Insula case and some of the other cases on there. So I'm familiar with the material that they have that they're discussing, and then I've got stuff that they don't have. So I don't know. I'm not I haven't really tapped in, but I should. And Zach, do you? Are you checking in with the internet at cas-uh-LARE-oh in Slough community?
Not really. It's just a matter of sort of time, I think. But I think it is interesting that people, even before this show came out, people would be discussing the case or find out Christian's name and be looking at Danny's files and not realizing that the reason that they have Danny's files was because Christian had gone to Missouri and gotten his files and they were on archive.org. And so Christian in some ways is like the early Johnny Appleseed of the Danny Casolaro story with the internet, taking it all the way back to 2015.
Well, I apologize to the audience if we've confused you at all in the last hour. If you want to watch the full series, it's The Octopus Murders, 4 parts. It's on Netflix. Christian Hansen and Zachary Treitz have been our guests, and they are the producers. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you so much.
All Q&A programs are available on our website or as a podcast on our C-SPAN Now app.